What do we do about a Supreme Court that violates the Constitution and upholds an unconstitutional law that eviscerates our private health care system? What do we do about a President of the United States who proudly proclaims his defiance to the rule of law and to the limits placed on him under our Constitution? What do we do about a Congress that passes massive spending bills that are going to destroy this society by taking down the economy? Maybe not during our lives, possibly, but certainly during the lives of your children and grandchildren. What are we going to do when we have such a massive bureaucracy, 2 million or so, so many agencies and departments and offices and divisions, we don't know how many, that can issue regulations when you're not even looking, that have the power of a federal statute with fines and penalties, even strict liability, prison time, that affect everything in your home, everything outside your home? So much for privacy in the bedroom. There is none. Everything in your bedroom is regulated. Everything's in your bedroom is regulated. Your furniture, the paint, the carpet, blankets, the sheets, the mattress, the pillows, the windows, the roof over your head. Of course, the only thing that's not regulated, well, I'm not going there. Anyway, most of us, millions of us can agree that we don't need to be persuaded any longer about the perilous state of what's left of this republic. We need no further persuasion. We know the federal government's out of control. We know that the limits, the firewalls in the Constitution have been breached. We know we sit on the edge of our chairs every June, waiting for some Supreme Court decision to come down, hoping that Anthony Kennedy or John Roberts or somebody doesn't screw up again. We see these candidates run for re-election in the House every 2 years, in the Senate every 2 years, a third of them run, lying through their teeth. We're going to repeal Obamacare, says McConnell. And then he says, oh, I need 60 members. Well, by that count, he needs 67 to overcome a presidential veto. But that's not what he said. They said they will not fund Obama's unconstitutional amnesty, but they are going to fund it. The Republicans have funded every damn penny of Obama's $7.5 trillion debt since he's been in office. And they have funded trillions of dollars of their own under Republican presidents. Where is this going to end? How is this going to end? If we are serious about these perils, we say we are as conservatives, we say we are as independent thinkers, as constitutionalists, then what are we going to do about it? Elect more Republicans? Elect more Republicans to what? Where?
Where?
You see, the constitutional system isn't really in place anymore. Oh, we get to go to the polls and vote. It's almost like a tradition. Let's go out on July 4th and watch the fireworks. When we vote, if we, meaning constitutional conservatives, win, what have we won exactly? Well, we've stopped one of them or some of them from getting elected, or from controlling one of the institutions of government for some period of time. Has that changed the course of the nation? Has that changed the power of the courts? Has that changed the power of the bureaucracy? Has that in any way put serious limits on the power of the presidency the next time the left is in there? And what about George Bush? And what about George Bush? And what about the coming George Bush, who liked federal power and central power? Just elect more Republicans. At least we're not Democrats, you know. We love the country. They hate the country. And besides, they're traditional conservatives. They can win. Read Edmund Burke.
Who's going to secure the border?
Nobody.
Who's going to cut the debt?
Nobody.
Who's going to give us our Constitution back?
None of them.
And so here we are. It's like being in an aquarium, stuck in this one aquarium. We're stuck in this aquarium, trying to figure out, swimming in circles, banging against the, how do we get out of this thing? Get out of this thing. Ladies and gentlemen, why are we in
why are we in the damn aquarium?
We're not. Our heads are. Our minds are. That's our mindset. We are stuck here in the aquarium of the Beltway, and everything inside, all the poison, all the dislocation, all the degrading of our constitutional system, that's where it's taking place.
It's not taking place in Dallas, Texas. It's not taking place in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. It's not taking place in Peoria, Illinois. It's not taking place in Portland, Maine. Things take place there that we don't like.
But the federal constitutional disarray and destruction is taking place inside the Beltway in a few buildings in Washington, D.C. And we seem to think that if that's all we focus on, if that's all we do, change the leadership, nudge them over here, tweak over there, a new congressional committee, maybe a new speaker, that'll fix it. It won't fix a damn thing. You don't have to believe me. It hasn't, has it? I'm the only one who's going to tell you this. The others stop short. They're never going to step over that line. They stop short. Why? Because they're stuck with everybody else. Because they will not embrace fully
the framers of the Constitution. On the one hand, we conservatives like to say that we revere our Constitution. Do we really revere the Constitution? How so? What do we do to promote it and defend it and restore it? Elect Republicans? Do they really revere the Constitution? How many of them actually talk about it in any significant way? When's the last time Mitch McConnell talked about it? When's the last time he read it, along with those immigration laws? They put their hands on a Bible and swear to uphold a Constitution they never read. And they have no intention of upholding it. Do you, Orrin Hatch? No, you don't. It's all talk. And then they try and manipulate you and me. You know, the hordes, the masses, as Marx referred to us. The masses. We're to be manipulated and controlled. Oh, yeah, they'll just talk about, oh, we want to help the middle class. Oh, yeah, yeah, we're going to grow the middle class from the middle class out. Oh, yeah, here's a few tax pennies, a few crumbs, as they're pouring on the debt and the power of the bureaucracy. Many of these departments weren't created by Democrats. They were created by Republicans. When Reagan tried to get rid of the Department of Education, it was a Republican Senate that stopped him. And I can go on and on. The fact of the matter is, we can no longer be schizophrenic about this. We can no longer pretend to support constitutional republicanism, limited government, federalism, the power of state legislatures in particular, and then reject the only recourse that's provided to us in the law,
in the Constitution.
Why should we reject the one part of the Constitution that provides us with our answer? Why do we embrace Madison? Why do we embrace Mason? Why do we embrace the framers of the Constitution
and then reject what they did? That's what liberals do. I would never presume to substitute myself for one of those great, magnificent, brilliant patriots. How absurd. What I'm doing is presenting to you what they did, presenting to you what they said, providing you with information that you're not going to get in the media, you're not going to get from conservative think tanks, you're not going to get from most conservative websites, you're not going to get from some of these fraud, pseudo, phony conservative delegates and state senators who prefer to talk about this stuff than help us save this republic, because the truth of the matter is that if enough state legislatures get together in the aggregate, they have more power than the Supreme Court, Congress, the president, and the bureaucracy put together. Ooh, did you know that? Is that scary? No. That's our salvation. And isn't it amazing that conservatives win more at these state-level elections than they do anywhere else? 2010, historic victory. 2014, unbelievable. Because people at the grassroots are trying to express themselves in every way they know possible. Going to the ballot box, voting for delegates, voting for state senators, county commissioners, anybody who will help and listen. And the funny thing is, there's a fire alarm in the Constitution that takes the power from the authoritarian, top-down, centralized operators, those politicians, that bureaucracy in Washington, D.C., and you pull the alarm, and the power reverses itself. A mere few brilliant sentences in Article 5 of the Constitution, the Amendment Clause of the Constitution. You see, Congress, by two-thirds vote of both houses, can propose amendments to the states to ratify, requiring three-fourths of the state legislatures or state conventions to ratify. It also provides for the states to do the same thing. Well, that makes sense. Congress is not going to support amendments or pass amendments to send to the states that reduce or relinquish some of their power. For instance, Congress will never send an amendment to the states to limit their terms.
Will they?
Congress will never send an amendment to the states to limit their profligate spending and taxing. Will it?
Never. Never.
Congress will never send an amendment to the states to protect national sovereignty. Will it?
Of course not.
Because Congress is doing all these things with the president, with this, with the imprimatur of the courts,
and with the aid and abetting of a massive bureaucracy it created and you, by coercion, fund. So the framers said, what do we do about this when we're long gone? We've written the most perfect document we can. We've written the most perfect document we can. But what if people abuse their power? What if these institutions that we've never set up before get out of control?
What if they use the Constitution to abuse the Constitution? What if they use the law to plunder the people?
We've got this fire alarm in the Constitution.